So alhamdulillah, today we talk about the second part, the Hajj part. So last week we spoke about the Umrah. You know, an Umrah is just optional. You can do any time. Umrah is 2 or 3 hours. Any time during the whole year. 2 or 3 hours, you do the Umrah. And Umrah is around the Kaaba. So Umrah is, you do the Ihram, you do the intention, Labbayka Umrah, Allah, I'm coming for Umrah, from the Miqat, from the airplane, and wearing the Ihram for the men, and the ladies wear anything comfortable. But the Ihram applies to the men, that they don't cover the head, they don't wear hats, they don't wear socks, they don't wear tie, they don't wear singlet, they don't wear any clothes, just the Ihram. 2 towels, one around the waist and one around the shoulder. So they did the intention, they put the Ihram on, they come to the Kaaba, and they do Tawaf 7 times. They do the Sa'i between Safa and Marwa, 7 laps, and they go and cut the hair. That's it. Yeah, whenever we say Tawaf, we're going to say the 2 rak'ah after Tawaf. Yeah? Whenever you do the Tawaf around the Kaaba, you pray 2 rak'ah, and the 2 rak'ah, قُلْ يَيُّهَا الْكَفْرُونَ قُلْ وَاللَّهُ أَحَدْ, similar to Sunnah of Maghrib. And that's Umrah. Then the people, who, lucky one who goes before the Hajj start, before the 8th of the Hijjah. Because Hajj is 8th of the Hijjah, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. That's Hajj. That's Hajj. And sometimes you can even go 12. So 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. 5 days, you can do perfect Hajj. Sometimes the prime ministers and kings and royals, they just go on the 9th of the Hijjah, you know, the Arafah. They just do Arafah. There is a palace there. They go there, have a coffee and something, and that's it. They can appoint somebody to throw the Jamarat on the second day and do the Hajj, and they go back to the palace, back to the country. So it's also accepted Hajj. So the lucky one who goes from New Zealand, they go and spend the whole week before the Hajj in Mecca and a few days in Medina. Amazing. So the brothers, will, those who go into, you're going to Mecca, Ahmed, eh? Okay, so Ahmed, Mecca first? Medina first. So Ahmed will go Medina first. And Medina is nothing to do with Hajj. Okay, so you can do perfect Hajj without visiting Medina. But obviously, if you're in the land of Haramain, if you're in the land of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I mean, it's just your heart will not be at peace if you don't go to Medina. And Medina is the history of Islam. Medina is the pride of Islam. Medina is the jewel of Islam. Medina is where the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Masjid, where the Sahaba, where the Battle of Uhud, where Badr is, where the trench is, you know, where the Sahaba is buried, tens of thousands of them. So this is what you feel in Medina. You just immerse yourself in the history of Islam. And of course, every rak'ah in the Masjid al-Nabawi is 1,000 rak'ah. Every salah in the Masjid of the Prophet ﷺ is 1,000 salah anywhere else. What is 1,000 salah? If you divide that by 5, it's 200 days. What is that? 200 days is almost 7 months? Every salah equals 7 months. Inshallah, we're patching and filling all the holes in our salah. In our life, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of us. So, this is 1,000, but if you come and pray by the Kaaba, is 100,000. So if you have 7 months times 100, that's 700 months. That is about 60 years worth. Every salah. You pray dhuhr at the Masjid al-Haram, as if you prayed for 60 years dhuhr. You pray Asr, 60 years Asr. Maghrib, 60 years. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all, inshallah, and invite us again and again. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said something amazing. He says, Tabi'u bayn al-Hajj wal-Umrah. He says, keep going for Hajj and Umrah. He says, don't stop. So people says, but it costs quite a bit of money. He says, al-Hajj wal-Umrah yanfiyan al-Faqr. Hajj and Umrah will wipe away your needs and poverty. Will actually give barakah for you. Don't worry about spending. Subhanallah, that's what the Prophet ﷺ said. So the brothers will, in Medina, they go Medina first, they will enjoy Medina, and then the tour leaders, the agent, the company that takes them, will say, we're going to go to Mecca. I think it will be about the 5th of the Hijjah. They're starting to come down. And they will do their Ihram near Medina. in an area that's called Abyar Ali, a big mosque. Oh, subhanAllah. It's a compound. You can drive trucks around it. Just very, you know, when you see a mosque in Saudi Arabia, like, you don't, it's not small mosque, it's massive. Showers and everything is inside. So you go in there, you get off the bus, you have your shower, put your ihram on, and you do your intention for Hajj. You're coming for Hajj now. But those who arrive in Medina straight, they will do intention for Umrah. Because they haven't come to Mecca yet. So if you arrived in Mecca and gone to Medina, like Brother Sifra will be, you go to Mecca, you stay in Mecca for a week, then you go to Medina, and you come with everybody else. Everybody come from Medina together. They unite them together and come from Medina. If you've been to Mecca, you've done your Umrah. If you haven't, then you intend the Umrah. But if you come from Mecca and you want to do another Umrah, no problem. You can intend another Umrah. You say, Allah, labbaik Umrah. I'm coming for Umrah. You come for Umrah, straight to Mecca, straight to the Kaaba, you do the Tawaf, you do the two rak'ah behind Maqam Ibrahim, you do the Sa'i bin Safa and Marwa, you cut your hair. It's Umrah. But the thing is, you don't have to get out of Ihram, because Hajj is tomorrow. If this, you know, if you are in the 7th, tomorrow is the 8th, Hajj starts. What they do, they take you into a flat, the company we're going with, it takes you to a flat near the Jamarat. It's called Aziziyah suburb. There's so many suburbs there, Aziziyah and Shisha, very famous suburbs. Everybody talks about it. You mention Aziziyah, taxi knows where it is. So about 20 riyal to the Kaaba. Because around the Kaaba now, the price will become 10 times for the hotels. So only very rich people can stay where you stayed the first week. That's the idea. That's the only reason they take you out, you know, from this area. But also, there's another morals behind it, in the Hajj itself. When you arrive, you stay in a 5-star hotel. Absolutely, just everything is just as if you in any city in Europe. Showers and with all this shampoo and conditioners and, you know, different types. You go down to the food court, oh subhanAllah, you can't see the end of it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't, He's not inviting us to enjoy ourselves and sleep in a 5-star hotel. Then He says, no. You're going to go into a flat. So you leave that 5-star hotel into a flat in Aziziyah. And the flat is about, you know, just a flat. 4 people in a bedroom and you got a small laundry and a small bathroom. Just like any flat. Clean, but not as anyway as near as. And also the food will be not as flash as the one in the hotel. So you downgrade it. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, oh, that's too much. Still, you're coming for Hajj. Then in Arafah, they put you in a tent. Literally, a big high-ceiling tent. No air condition, nothing. It's a carpet and a fan. So you go from the 5-star hotel into a flat, into a tent. Then Allah says, oh, no, you're still too much. You're going to sleep in the street. So after Arafah, you go to Muzdalifah, and literally, you're sleeping, and all around you is the fume of the buses and dust of the people walking. You're absolutely gone from your home, your comfort, into a hotel, just to adjust quickly, but then straight away you go into a flat, straight away into a tent, straight away into the street. And that is the best night of Hajj. That's the night where you need to see yourself and say, okay, that's me. That's me compared to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm a slave. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one, you know, the Most High. He is the one that deserves of all respect. He is the one that deserves all opinion. He is the one, not me. I deserve the dust. I deserve to be here. And no complaining. No complaining. Wallahi, the best night sleep I had, it was the night of Muzdalifah. Wallahi, it's just, everybody says something similar, but it's just incredible. You just lie down after praying Maghrib and Isha, coming from Arafah, it's the biggest day of Hajj. It's just, oh, subhanAllah, it's just, you can't describe the feeling of Hajj. So back again, you come from Medina, you arrive at this mosque, Abyar Ali, it's called Abyar Ali, and you do Ihram, and you do Labbaika, either Umrah or Hajj, it depends, yeah? But most of the people do Umrah again, even if they have done one, they do one for their father, one for their mother, one for their wife, one for, yeah? So you can absolutely most welcome to intend another Umrah for someone else if you've done yours, yeah? And then you get on the bus and labbaik, Allahumma labbaik, all the way. Labbaik, Allahumma labbaik. Amazing journey. amazing journey. You will see people from all different cultures, all different languages, all different places. And the bus stops, you know, for checkpoints, people getting up on the bus, so smiley. The happiest Saudi you'll ever hear and see. They come on the bus with boxes, gift boxes. They have dates and biscuits and crackers and cheese and zamzam, you know, and they just come out and they're full of smiles. How many in the bus? How many in the bus? And they just, if you ask for more boxes can come in. Just like an army of servants in every checkpoint. The checkpoint is just to make sure that those on the bus, you know, are on the bus. They're not missing anybody. And there is no one is, you know, just trying to cheat the system and get into Mecca and cause more crowd. Because if they left it open, it'd be 10 million. And the facilities won't cope, and there'll be more accidents. That's why the whole checkpoint. But for those who are going for Hajj, don't worry about the organization. Don't worry about the checkpoint and the time and the police and the cars. Don't worry about it. You are there for ibadah, and the minute you have the intention here, the angel has started to write good deed. You're sitting in the bus 10 hours. This 10 hours payment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're not going to get 9 hours. Wallahi, Allah will pay you 10 times 700. Will pay you 7,000 hours. There is no employer will pay this. Nobody. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, nafaqat al-hajj. The spending in hajj is multiplied by 700 times. 700 times. And that is anything from the minute you put your intention that you're going for hajj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from all of us. So you arrive at Aziziyah, not now, they're not going to take you to Mecca for the Hajj days. They put those, you know, our groups. If you're not the Prime Minister, then you're going to stay in a flat. You leave your luggage, and all you're going to take is the bare minimum because you're going to the tent in Mina. You're going to go to start your Hajj on the 8th of the Hijjah is the bare minimum. What's the bare minimum? Your phone, your charger, your just a small string bags. Because you are in ihram. You don't need clothes. You don't need anything. Yeah? Maybe a towel. The company will give you a sheet to cover yourself with from the windows or something or the air condition if you want to go to sleep. And in the tent, they give you a mattress that the fold away becomes a seat. And that's all the space you allocated. You can sit on it, you sleep on it in the night. That is all the space. You put your bag in it. You can't take anything from, there is no room behind you or in front of, there is no room to walk between. The space is so, so restricted. That's all anybody and everybody is allocated. Just one block. See, if you go there or you want to wake up in the night and you go out, I don't know how you do it. You walk between the legs of all the people on the beach. And this massive tent, about 400 people, in one side men, 400 in the other side women. This is the time where they separate them also. This is the 8th of the Hijjah. It's called Yawm al-Tarwiyah. Yeah? Yawm al-Tarwiyah. What does that mean? Tarwiyah. Tarwiyah comes from two words. From Tarawi and from Riwaya. Tarawi, it means take your time. Think about tomorrow. Relax. And think about tomorrow. Think about the day of Arafah. It's tomorrow. Arafah is tomorrow. That is just overwhelming feeling. It's so difficult sometimes from what's going on to really grab that moment and say, tomorrow is Arafah. Tomorrow is the biggest day in my history, in my life. Tomorrow. So that is the whole idea about the day of Arafah. This is about tarawi. Just concentrate on to prepare for tomorrow. Prepare your dua list, prepare your intention, prepare you know physically, even have a rest so tomorrow you can be full of energy. Don't get exhausted today. The other meaning is riwaya. Riwaya is like the stories you narrate. See, even narrate like riwaya come from the same root. Maybe narrate the story of that day. What is the story of the 8th of the Hijjah? It is the day Ibrahim alayhi salam was getting all those dreams to slaughter his son, and he's saying, I'm thinking about it. How am I going to tell him? What is he going to say? How am I going to... Ibrahim alayhi salam, now there's no hesitation. He's going to offer his son. He's not going to offer a sheep or a cow or a camel. He is going to offer his son tomorrow. That is incredible that some human being have gone through this feeling on the 8th of the Hijjah. That what Ibrahim has gone through. That's why it's called Yawm al-Tarwiyah. And we all know, he went and told his son was 14, and he told him, Ya Bunayya, Inni ara fil manam, Inni athbahuka, fanzur mada tara. My son, my dear son, I love you so much. That's what Bunayya means. It's like maybe he's hugging him and crying. That's what he imagined on the 8th of the Hijjah. That the father, who is 80 years old, now his son is able to help him out. He's 14. Now he's the only time he says, go and get this, go and go there. Now he says, Allah is telling him, no. From you, I'm not going to accept a sheep or a cow. I'm going to accept something more dearer to you. Money is dear to every one of us. $700, $800, $1,000. You feel, oh, I'm going to sacrifice all that. No. You're going to sacrifice your son. No human being will go through this test. Nobody will pass this test. Nobody. It's very difficult. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never do that to any human being. Will never allow a human being to kill his son. But this was just the test that there is no other. This is the ceiling of all tests. There is no more difficult test than that. And he says, absolutely happy, no problem. I'll do it. I'm just thinking about how all day on the 8th, how I'm going to tell him tomorrow. And when he told him, the son, he just got all the answers correct. He says, my father, Ya Abati, my dear father, and hug him again and says, If'al ma tu'mar, you do what you commanded, never hesitate, never think about it. Put my face in the sand, not to have eye contact. Satajiduni, you will absolutely no doubt find me, insha'Allah. Allah will give me the energy and the strength. Patient. I'll be patient. I will not resist. They go, and the father's dragging his son, taking his son to an area with a knife to sacrifice. This is, this is human. It's not humanly possible. But our fathers Ibrahim did it. And that's why we were walking around there. In Mina, that's what happened. That's what the Jamarat is. There is area where the shaitan will come and whisper to Ibrahim, Ibrahim, you, what are you doing? He's the only son. He's the only one giving you a hand. You're an old man. People will say you're crazy. People will say you lost your mind. And he will just go down and get pimples and just, A'udhu billah min shaitan rajim. A'udhu billah min shaitan rajim. And that's what we do in Mina. So this whole Mina, all this crowd and stampede and jamarat and heat, you don't lose the point that you are walking in the footstep of somebody who had the most difficult test ever. It's not the heat. It's not the police pushing and shoving. It's not the road is blocked. It's not that you can't get out now. It's not that somebody is not giving you, there's no food, the food is late. No. It's not the toilets are busy. All these are tests and we fail. These small ones, you go to the toilet and they're all dirty. Oh, you hear the worst of things. You go there and it's full and the people standing in the queue and somebody can't wait like someone else and they push and run before you turn and you can hear the worst of things. That's our test. People having all this, tea and coffee and stuff, and the whole hallway between the tent is like a rubbish dump. New Zealand, Australia tent. I'm not talking about some country that, New Zealand and Australia are together, and opposite the tent, wallahi, mountain of rubbish. Literally, diggers have to come and put in trucks. So our test is that area that you when you look around and say, SubhanAllah. SubhanAllah, we human being, we're so, so helpless. If there is no proper toilet, we lose our patience. If there's no comfortable bed, if there is no my private to plug my phone and charge my, or just, where is my pillows? God disappeared. Just somebody else grabbed it. Or your sheet, or somebody using your charger. Or a phone is burning, charging and is very, very hot. In your bed. It's not yours. It's been there for 2 or 3 days. All these tests. Or some people fighting. Yeah, literally, fighting. Literally. Or some people smoking, may Allah protect us. So these are, Mina, don't think that they're going to go there and find angels around. No. You will find human being, and everybody have their own test. But compare all these tests to Ibrahim alayhi salam. He was being told, sacrifice the dearest thing. And there is no human being that loved the children more than the father. Wallahi, the father, in a drowning ship, they will lift their son. And they drown themselves first. In a burning house, they will go inside the house and chuck the children out and they burn inside. And they're happy to do it. If their son is sick, they will stay up all night. They will sell everything to give to the doctors. If somebody told them it's at the end of the world, you find medicine, they will travel to the end of the world to save the children. So don't you know? We all know it, that Ibrahim alayhi salam loves his son Ismail more than anything you can imagine. But he loves Allah more. He was more than happy to sacrifice. That happened in Mina. So when he arrived in Mina, this emotion should be so high and should be alive. This is one. Then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Mina, he met the Ansar. The Ansar that came from Medina to invite him, Bay'at al-Aqaba al-Ula, Bay'at al-Aqaba al-Thaniya, was in Mina. The deal, the agreement, the invitation for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to come to Medina, it was happening in Mina. When the Prophet ﷺ was looking for a safe haven for Islam, in Mina they met. He met the first 6 Ansari and then he met the 12 Ansari and he met the 73 after that. It was all in Mina. In Mina, the surah, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ was revealed. So when you are in Mina, yes, it's a tent, yes, the food is late, yes, the food is cold, yes, so crowded, yes, all the stuff, but don't lose the lesson that this place is incredible. It's just so amazing. So the 8th of the Hijjah is all about that. To make dua, to make istighfar, to absolutely 100% dig deep into your heart and sincerity and say, Ya Allah, you are the king. You are the master. I'm the slave. Please accept my Hajj. Please help me tomorrow. Please accept me tomorrow. And then that's it. You pray Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib and Isha in the tent. Short, the 4 rak'ah becomes 2 rak'ah on time. So it's all like preparation. Tomorrow after Fajr, the bus will come to take everybody to Arafah. So from the tent, with the tent in Mina has air condition. You go to Arafah, the tent has no air condition. It's only used once a year. It's only used that day. It has carpet for those rich ones like us. There's people walking around in the mountains in Arafah. So even that is very, very hot, very uncomfortable. But there, if you walk outside if you can. If you can, I couldn't. I walked outside for about 10 minutes and I said, I'm losing my concentration from the heat. There's every tree, there's some trees, every tree is occupied. There's people underneath it. And you know, there's about 20 people under a very small tree. So you go up by the fence of the hut itself or the tent itself, and it's so hot, you can't make dua. So you go inside again and sit by the fan. Every group, about 20 people, have a big fan, industrial fan. And you need to accustom yourself, I need to make dua now. Forget these people, forget what they're doing, and just concentrate. Close your eyes and make dua. Cry. This is the day. Arafah is the day. And don't waste your time looking for anything else. Just have your bottle of water next to you to sip on it. And this is the day. This is Hajj actually. The Prophet ﷺ say, Al-Hajj Arafah. Hajj is Arafah. If you won Arafah, you've won Hajj. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Inna Allah yubahi al-Malaik. Allah will call all the angels to have a look at Arafah. They say Arafah is a verb in Arabic. It means to know, brother Arif, you know, Arif means he knows. Ya'raf, yeah? Ma'rifah is all this knowledge. So Arafah is to get to know who you are. This is the place to get to know who you really, really are. Compared to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, compared to Allah creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so proud of all those millions of people leaving the loved one, leaving their business, leaving their daily life to come into this barren desert and cry and says, Ya Allah, please forgive us. Ya Allah, we follow your messenger. Ya Allah, we are, you know, we're coming, answering the call. Arafah, they say, is the day that Adam alayhi salam, you know, is the place where Adam alayhi salam repented. Is the same spot. So you spend the whole day in Arafah. This is the 9th of the Hijjah now. You spend, this is Hajj, I'm talking about Hajj. Yom al-Tarwiyah is the 8th. The 9th is Arafah. You spend the whole day in Arafah. You pray Dhuhr and Asr together at the time of Dhuhr. You pray Dhuhr and Asr together at the time of Dhuhr. So you have from midday all the way till Maghrib to make dua only. There is no prayer, there is nothing else but making dua, sincere dua. For you and for everybody else, you need to make a list now. You need to practice the list now. You need to absolutely understand it now before that day. Because on that day, it's just, it's not for preparation, it is for action. So Arafah. Then, it seems like it's like the end of Arafah. It's like all the burdens of life is lifted off everybody's shoulder. It's just something comes on the people of Arafah that there's just like Eid. They're all happy and laughing and smiling just suddenly at Maghrib time. Everybody's so happy. The queue was long. You can't see the queue. It's just going around like snakes in the building. And you're standing carrying whatever you're carrying, waiting for the bus to turn up. You don't know which bus is yours. But everybody is happy. There's the moment in Hajj where nobody's arguing, nobody's yelling, everybody is just so happy. This is like the gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the proof that this is the day. Then you get in the bus and you go to Muzdalifah in the bus at night time. Muzdalifah is not, all this area are not very far from each other. Yeah, but because of the crowds and because we are strangers to the place and because of the emotion, because of so tired, don't risk of saying, hey, I'm going to join any group or I'm going to walk. Just join your group and leave the organization for them. When you arrive at Muzdalifah, Muzdalifah is just the barbed wired areas, just camps on the ground. There's nothing in it. It's all sectioned, and they have a sign in every gate, literally. They give you, lucky one like us, they give you a thin mat to lie on. And they say, don't bring it back, just lie on it and you leave it in place, and in the morning you wake up and back to Mina. What you do in Muzdalifah? You pray Maghrib and Isha. First thing, you pray Maghrib and Isha, Jama'ah, and then sleep. The Sunnah, that's it. You pray Maghrib and Isha and sleep. Why? Because tomorrow is full day, absolutely packed. Tomorrow, Zaid day for everybody else, not for the people in Hajj. People in Hajj have the Eid already, Arafah. Arafah is the Eid for the people of Hajj. That's where they really, really celebrate. But the Eid day itself, it's full. So you stay in Muzdalifah, you're sleeping literally in the ground with a, it's really, really, really strange place. But if you're lucky one, if you're really lucky, you wake up in the night and have a look. Whoa. When you wake up in the night and have a look, wallahi, it's like the Day of Judgment. It's the number, hundreds of thousands you can see with your own eye, and they're all like dead. Just the sleep, they are dead. It's just your heart, just really crazy. And suddenly in the morning, they all wake up and march towards Mina. This is the biggest march. It's the only time where all of them marching together, heading towards the Jamarat, saying the same thing. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Labbaika la sharika laka labbay. Incredible. Very, very, very powerful feeling. It's just amazing. You look on the right, there's Chinese. You look on the left, there's China. There is, you know, Japan, Russia, Africa, Europe, you know. Just amazing. Islam, that is the absolutely the beauty of this religion, is the multicultural and the love and respect and kindness and generosity that comes in this difficult moment. Everybody wants to give you a bottle of water. Everybody wants to give you, to share some. Everybody wants to give you an umbrella to give you a shield. Everybody wants just to give you the way to pass by. And the marsh, all those millions of people, as if exactly the same, like the resurrection. You were sleeping in a Muzdalifah and you all wake up like the Day of Judgment. And you march towards where? Towards the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, towards the palace. You're going to Mecca on foot. On foot. A very easy, big, wide road. If people listen to the instruction and follow instruction, it will be very, very safe. So they have jamarat, seven jamarat only, seven peoples. And they're going to stone one jamara, the biggest jamara on that day. So the Eid day, the 10th of the Hijjah, is packed. It has five things, five actions to do. Number one, you're going to go to the jamarat and throw the jamara. Number two is you're going to do the hadi, the sacrifice. But we don't do it ourselves, the company does it. So we wait for the company to text us and to tell, you know, to tell the group that it's all done. Once that is done on your behalf in freezing work, you go and shave your hair. Once you shave your hair, you take your ihram off. Now you're out of ihram, you go home and have a shower in that flat and put whatever clothes you're comfortable in and head to the Kaaba, to the tawaf of Hajj. That is the biggest tawaf in Hajj. This is where the most packed place on the face of the earth. The things you read here, they're doing tawaf here, you gasp for air. This is amazing, amazing feeling. And nowadays that they open up the whole sahn, it's called sahn around the Kaaba, it's all open. It will fit maybe 200,000-300,000 people on the ground. And all the levels will be packed. It's just an incredible feeling. You do your tawaf, Hajj, and you do the sa'i for Hajj. Exactly the same tawaf. You have, you know, now you don't have ihram on, you have the clothes on, it's comfortable, and you just start with a black stone, Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, you know, and you go one, and two, and three, and four, seven, and between the Rukn al-Yamani and the Hajar, you say, Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana fi al-akhirah hasana qina adhab al-nar. Don't even try to kiss or touch the black stone, it will be impossible, absolutely impossible. Then you pray the two rak'ah, and you do sa'i, and that's it. That is the Hajj, your Hajj is done. Your Hajj is finished. All you're going to do now is Ayyam al-Tashriq. You're going to go back to the tent in Mina and stay there for 3 days. The 11th, the 10th, 11th and 12th. So the 11th, the 12th and the 13th. The 11th and the 12th and the 13th, you're going to stay in the tent doing nothing else but thanking Allah and remembering Allah and making dua. What is it? Why? Hajj is finished. What is this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his deen asking us to stay in the tent. It's exactly what they do in the big corporate. You know, we have big corporate in the world nowadays. They have conference where they meet 5,000 people. Yeah, I used to work in one of these, you know, Oracle and PeopleSoft. There are more than 5,000 people. And we meet in the conference and you have the whole day news and updates and speeches, and then what? They break into workshop, into small group. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did. He just have the whole 4 million together in the biggest conference in the whole year for the Muslim Ummah, and then you go into your tent with 400, 500 people, and you need to talk about Islam. You need to talk about the community. You need to talk about who are you and where are you from and how is things and how can we help and change phone numbers and learn from their experience and they learn from your experience. Amazing, amazing time. This was the best time. You sit down and you find beautiful brothers from Australia or from Europe and they exchange their experience. They change their, you know, ideas and how they run schools, what books they run, how they run classes, how they run, all these ideas come in. Or they ask questions. So many brothers who don't, they just came to religion. They have no idea. And they keep asking questions and they're fascinated by the answers and the history and the stories you tell them about the Sahaba or the Prophets or the Quran or the Tafsir. Amazing time. Amazing time. But then Allah puts another miracle in that days. You're not going to sit in the tent and just isolate yourself with your group. He forced us to leave the tent every day to go out and do Jamarat. Every day. You go out and do the three Jamarat. 21 stones, 7 each. Why? To meet the people in the street. You meet all the people in the street at the Jamarat and you talk to him and you talk to them and say, Assalamu alaikum, and where are you from? And you give a gift. And that is the whole idea. It's for the Muslim to break that ice between each other. For the Muslim just to break the barrier. It's not because I'm African and you are, you know, white. No, no. There's no. We are all Muslim. We all brothers. We all have the same concern. We all make dua for each other. That is amazing, amazing experience that Hajj end with. In these 3 days, it's called Ayam al-Tashriq. It's called Tashriq because in the old days they used to dry the meat because they didn't have freezers and the fridges. So what they used to do, they used to cut the sacrifice, all these millions of tons of meat, they used to dry it and send it also all around Arabia, all around the world for the poor, so it lasts for a very long time. Nowadays, alhamdulillah, the Saudi have amazing work that just, you can imagine going on 24 hours and maybe for many, many days after for the Hajj. So this is in a nutshell, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from all the brothers and sisters who are going this year. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it Hajj mabrur. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable all of us to visit these beautiful places again and again. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us to visit. And maybe may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all to establish our biggest rukn of Islam, the rukn al-Hajj. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen wa jazakum Allah khair. Subhanakallah wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu alayk.